Ascent Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents How to Lead Your Family Business, Excelling Through Unexpected Crises, Choices, and Challenges by Julie Charlestein. Narrated by Julie Charlestein. Dedicated to Grandma and Grandpa, who gave me everything, to Abba, who taught me everything, and to the Suck It Crew, who are my everything. Introduction. Welcome, and I use that word carefully, to the family business. We've probably been in your mouth. I'm the CEO of Premier Dental Products, a company you've most likely never heard of. But like I said, we've probably been in your mouth. The products we sell are used in more than 75 countries around the world and include such popular items as Traxident hemostatic and retraction paste, which displaces soft tissue around your damaged tooth, the triple tray, the plastic gadget your dentist uses to take an accurate impression of your teeth when preparing a crown, and enamel pro prophy paste, which your dental hygienist uses when polishing your teeth to give you that fresh, straight from the dentist feeling. Trust and believe, I could go on and on about what makes these and other Premier products the most phenomenal things ever, but I can tell you're already over it. Let's just say that Premier is a name your dentist is probably very familiar with and trusts implicitly on a daily basis, which means that, again, without your knowing it, Premier has probably taken care of you. Business relationships don't get much more intimate than that. Premier was founded in 1913 by a dental instrument sharpener named Julius Charlestein, and the similarity of our names is no coincidence. Julius was my great-grandfather, and I am the fourth-generation member of the Charlestein family to run the company, which means that, yes, I am a grateful beneficiary of that old business tradition known as nepotism. Like many of America's most successful companies, from Mars Incorporated, the candy people, and News Corp, to Ford and Walmart, Premier is a family business, and my career story simply wouldn't be the same if I hadn't been born a Charlestein. It's a privilege to be part of a family that has nurtured an outstanding company over four generations and to inherit the values, traditions, and opportunities it has created. I never forget that fact. On the other hand, it would be a mistake to assume that my leadership journey has been a smooth and easy one. Quite the opposite. My family is a fun-loving and lively bunch of people whose occasional dysfunctions, including my own, are part of the charm. Family dramas can be the most intense dramas of all. Have you ever seen the Giudices and the Gorgas on The Real Housewives of New Jersey? You'll come to learn through this book that I am obsessed with all reality TV, especially on Bravo. And being in business together doesn't make those family dramas any simpler. Getting back to nepotism. I'm sure some people in family businesses might try to take advantage of it, figuring that power and money will flow their way automatically. Not my jam, although sometimes I wish it was. If anything, I've always felt an intense pressure to prove myself, to earn my reputation, and to demonstrate that I have what it takes to lead the company my family created and not to be the one that fucks it up. The person I particularly wouldn't want to disappoint is my grandfather, Morton Charlestein, or Mr. M, as he was affectionately known by those at Premier. Grandpa was just the best. Wise, humble, gentle yet tenacious, and he established values and leadership principles that I strive to embody. He made Premier into a company that is universally respected throughout our industry, and his insightful sayings, lovingly referred to as Mortonisms, are frequently quoted by leaders not just at Premier, but in the industry overall. I'll be citing them throughout this book. So I've been acutely conscious of the expectations that go with my name. Some people at Premier and in our broader industry expected that I would rise to the challenge. A few expected that I would fail, and a couple may have even looked forward to watching that happen. But the external pressures that I felt were nothing compared to the internal pressures that I created for myself. I hadn't planned to follow my grandfather and my father into the executive suite at Premier. While in college, I launched an independent career in news media, interning for 2 years at CNN. Later, I was a legislative assistant for the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee, APAC. That didn't end well, as I'll explain in a bit. I finally joined Premier full-time in 2003 after I'd earned my master's degree in business from Temple University, worked in the telecom industry at RCN Corporation, and gotten pregnant with my first child, my daughter Ruby. By then, I developed an array of talents, skills, and knowledge through years of work and business education. When I joined the business, I started out as one of Premier's product managers, a good perch from which to learn the intricacies of our company and the dental industry overall. My father, Gary Charlestein, was then CEO of Premier. I knew I had a lot to prove and a lot to learn. Though some of what I had to learn I didn't even realize. For example, I didn't anticipate how embroiling it would be to work with my father. Most of my learning came through on-the-job experience, many times with pains and frustrations attached. After I'd been in the business for a year or two, I realized that I needed to understand much more about how our organization was structured. How would leadership transition be handled? What plans were in place for long-term succession? What are various tax implications and structures? I was becoming increasingly engaged in thinking about the future of Premier, and I could see that the answers to questions like these would have a huge impact on that future. I asked to see the documents governing these matters. That kind of access is one of the privileges you get when you're one of the family. Well, they were somewhat vague, confusing, and lacking. Of course, they were legal documents, so there's that. They reflected Premier's century-old origins as a family enterprise, like many family businesses, in which major decisions were handled informally, via dinner table conversations, a not uncommon phenomenon. They didn't clearly address some of the real-life contingencies that could easily arise, creating the possibility that an unexpected emergency could create significant turmoil. When I raised these matters with my father, he would usually say that everything was fine and shuffle away. The shuffle, my father's signature move. I love it. Cute, clunky, and muffled. In this instance, a non-confrontational way of dealing with something by not dealing with it. He was generally happy for me to handle it if I so choose. These legal matters were the sort of nuanced, sometimes tedious business details that my father hated to get mired in, regardless of how important they might be. Truth be told, my father has always been far more drawn to the other side of his personality, his love of Hebrew scripture and tradition, and his work as a scholar and rabbi. He is amazing at that. He is not as passionate about running the family business, though as a respectful son, he took on that responsibility out of love for his father. But I knew that this structure had to be modernized, and I was both equipped to tackle the assignment and the only person willing to take it on. I think that was the biggest reason I got the job. The fact that nobody else wanted it or thought that it was terribly important. It would be intense, detail-oriented, challenging work, which nobody really loves. Oh, and another thing. I was also the only member of the family who didn't hate dealing with lawyers. Under the circumstances, reframing our company's governance documents so as to ensure our sound footing for future generations became my project. The job took almost a year. I spent countless hours with our company lawyers drafting, redrafting, and debating the contents of legal documents. One by one, the essential clauses fell into place, creating a clear, tightly organized business structure that could withstand any unforeseen economic or family crisis. The revisions we created would also save significant amounts of money that might otherwise go to taxes, legal fees, and other needless expenses. As we worked our way through the process, I tried to explain these benefits to my father, who remained uninterested. That was okay with me. I pressed on. Finally, the day came when the documents were ready to sign. The key family members with ownership stakes, my paternal grandparents, my dad, and my aunt, gathered with our small team of lawyers for the event at my grandparents' house in Penn Valley, a suburb of Philadelphia. I felt excited and gratified, knowing that we had come to this important moment in Premier's trajectory, a turning point that would solidify the company structure for generations to come. The papers were passed around the dining room table, and pens were circulated for the signing. Everyone signed and started gathering their things to leave. "Good job," I said to the group. "I'm glad that we got this done. Plus, we just saved a lot of money." As I spoke, there were smiles and nods around the table, but my father simply turned to me, his face blank, and said, "That's great, Julie. Now go pick out a dress for your grandmother to wear to dinner tonight." Whoa, that sucked. Now, don't get me wrong, I would do absolutely anything for my grandmother. Plus, picking out clothes with her or for her was one of my favorite things. You should have seen her closet. Still, to quote my favorite movie, My Cousin Vinny, yes, it's true, all will become clear as you read on. As Mona Lisa Vito said, maybe it was a bad time to bring it up. Maybe that was my dad's way of showing me that he still didn't care about the legal underpinnings of our business. Maybe it was his way of diminishing me. Maybe he just really wanted Graham to be ready on time. I don't exactly know what he meant by it. I just know that I felt like shit. Welcome to the family business. Let's be honest. Being a leader in a family business can be one of the most richly rewarding experiences ever. I have opportunities to lead and drive impactful, meaningful action plans and to take our amazing company to even greater heights of competitiveness and sustainability. I can help our people have meaningful careers, and they certainly help me. And I can carry on our family's legacy. One of those impactful opportunities arose fairly recently. Having become president of Premier in 2013 and then CEO in 2016, I had been leading the organization through a big transition on several fronts, a story I'll recount in more detail later in this book. One aspect of that evolution was shaping Premier from a typical "this is how we do it" kind of family company to one that uses sophisticated methodologies and software to track statistics and trends in our industry, analyzes what those trends reveal about shifting customer demands, and uses that information to identify growth opportunities and drive strategy. Introducing this philosophy and creating systems to implement my vision throughout a conservative, tradition-oriented organization has definitely not been all sunshine and rainbows. Some of our employees were understandably resistant at first. In a few cases, people who couldn't make the necessary shifts in mindset and working habits decided to take other opportunities outside of the company, and throughout the process, others had to move on. But little by little, people began to buy into the new approach. They felt my passion about the issue, probably because I talked and wrote about it constantly. When I'm locked onto a topic, I get seriously jazzed. Slowly, the data-driven culture I was trying to create began to emerge, and our people began to share my passion. In the midst of this transition, one of our most important executives announced his plan to retire. Matt Miller, always known as Light, was Premier's vice president of sales. And although I'd known for a while that Light might be departing soon, I wasn't fully prepared to deal with the reality. I was unprepared for several reasons. I would be losing an indescribably important member of our senior team, someone who had served me as a guide and mentor. I would be losing someone with 30 years of experience in the dental industry. Everyone, especially me, loved Light. I realized that once Light left, I would, for the first time, be the single most knowledgeable person on our executive team. That might be a normal position for many CEOs, and yes, I like to think I'm awesome. But I don't need to be the smartest person in the room, and I also like to have a historical and global perspective through which to view the future. The prospect of losing all that Light had to offer on that front made me uneasy. I absolutely needed to find an amazing person for the job, not just somebody good. Over the preceding year, I had been spending about 50% of my time screening candidates for the sales job in anticipation of Light's departure, and frustratingly coming up with bupkis. That's Yiddish for a big fat nothing. Now time was growing short. Light would be retiring in 5 months. I'd been hoping for at least a 6-month transition to his replacement. Factoring in the time to find this amazing person, that now wouldn't be possible. The pressure was suffocating. I stepped up the search into an even higher gear. I didn't want an old-school schmoozing and backslapping sales guy like the ones who dominated the industry in past decades. Because I was pushing Premier to be data-driven, I wanted a sales leader who had competency and passion in this area, someone who looked at things analytically and strategically and would use those insights to drive sales. Our outside recruiter scoured other companies in the dental industry looking for someone with those traits, but I didn't click with any of the candidates I met. Realizing that we had to broaden our scope, I directed the recruiter to look outside our industry. Specifically, I suggested we look for a candidate who had worked at AmerisourceBergen. ABC, as it's called, is a giant, $213 billion at the time of this writing, widely respected distributor of healthcare products. I figured that a candidate with a successful history at ABC would be a great fit with Premier because our two industries have similar distribution and manufacturing structures. Still, no luck. No candidate with the right combination of characteristics could be found. Days turned into weeks, weeks into months. Light would soon be gone, leaving a gaping void in our leadership team and in my psyche. My concern morphed into real anxiety. At 2 a.m., I found myself binge-watching videos of The Voice UK on YouTube rather than sleeping. Finally, one night, this time at 2:30, I decided to stop watching Will.i.am and instead turn my anxiety into productive energy. I clicked into LinkedIn, typed in AmerisourceBergen, and began to scroll through the profiles of company leaders. One individual jumped out at me. I'm not sure why. I had defined four types of experience I was looking for, and Petty had only one of the four. Sales leadership? No. Product analysis? No. Customer retention? No. Strategic analysis? Yes. Aside from working at ABC as a strategic analyst, on paper, Penny had nothing else that I was looking for. She had never sold anything in her life, nor had she been responsible for a sales team. But she was an expert at deeply analyzing markets and devising strategies for success. That talent was at the heart of what I wanted for Premier. I was transfixed by Penny's possibilities, which I somehow sensed were far bigger and more important than her lack of sales experience. At 4:30 a.m., I finally fell asleep. At least I had a plan for the next morning. I'd invite Penny to interview for a sales VP job. The next day, I printed out Penny's profile to show to Light and Dalton from marketing, who was also helping me to vet candidates. I waited quietly in the conference room as they sat reading her profile. When they were done, Light looked up and said simply, "No." I laughed, and the three of us talked about Penny's profile in some depth. I explained why her analytic skills could be exactly what Premier needed. At the end of the discussion, I asked my colleagues how they'd rate Penny on a 10-point scale. 5, they both responded. Clearly not a standing O. I laughed again. I'm going to speak with her anyway. Our recruiter arranged a meeting between me and Penny, and everything about her reinforced my instincts. Within 5 minutes, I knew that she was the person I'd been looking for, and after half an hour, I was ready to post her name on the office door. But I still wanted the support, or at least the acceptance of Light and Dalton. We're a very collaborative team at Premier, and Penny and Dalton would be working closely together. I told Light and Dalton, "I've spoken with Penny, and I'd like you to see her as well." I offered no further comments or information. Interviews were arranged for the next few days. Well, well, well. After meeting Penny, both Light and Dalton let me know, "You were right. She's exactly the person we need." I love it when that happens. Penny joined us soon thereafter, and ever since she has been helping to make Premier a truly data-driven company. Hiring her, in the face of dissent from smart, experienced executives whose opinions I consider really valuable, has been a great decision for Premier. A few months later, I decided to do something else differently, this time at a meeting of our advisory board. The group, which meets once a quarter to review our activities and plans and offer useful insights and advice, is composed of mostly non-dental industry business leaders. Premier's chief financial officer, my dad, my aunt, and me. Since the board had been advising me, the organization had evolved greatly, both in terms of structure and talent. In order to put faces with names and give the board members a greater understanding of the structure and our capabilities, I invited several of our recent hires to attend the meeting, explain their roles, and let the board members see the quality of people that the new Premier was now attracting, the people who would be driving our company forward. The presentations went great. I could see that the board members were impressed. The truth was that we'd brought in some really amazing talent. Once the Premier team members had left the room, we then turned to our usual board business, discussing the state of the company and our plans for the near future. Goodbye, warm and fuzzy. Hello, grill team. Despite the magnificent leadership team we'd been assembling, Premier sales were flat. And because we'd been making a number of necessary long-overdue investments, our cash flow picture was daunting. I was a little nervous about how the advisory board would react. The members are business leaders, whose counsel is always thoughtful and valuable, and I was worried they might feel I'd been misguided and making incorrect decisions. My emotions came to the surface when Thomas, one of the members of the board, started to speak. Thomas had been an executive with his own family's enterprise, so he has a deep understanding of the business and personal dynamics that come with running a family business. "Premier is your grandfather's company," Thomas began. Those few words immediately killed me. I've always considered being CEO of Premier an enormous responsibility, and one of the big reasons is the love and admiration I feel for my grandfather, Morton. I would never want to do anything to disappoint him. So now, having tried to justify to the advisory board the kinds of changes I was making, including the big investments, I was shaken to hear one of the members refer to Premier as your grandfather's company. I knew it was. That's why this moment was so searing. Was I doing the wrong things, making the wrong decisions? Would Grandpa be upset if he could see what I was doing with his sacred premiere? I started to tear up. While those thoughts consumed me, Thomas finished his sentence. But you can't run it like he did. You need to run it for today and for tomorrow, and that's exactly what you're doing. I exhaled, wiped my eyes, said thank you, and gave him a hug. Thomas grinned. Now go have a drink, he suggested. I knew then that Thomas was right about Grandpa would think, and I was so grateful to him for reminding me of it. And now I hope you are starting to understand why I love our family business. And great news, you can love yours too, maybe even love it more. As you continue to read through my experiences, familiar or parallel situations should become illuminated, allowing you to devise your own solutions, paths, and fun. Chapter 1. Julie and the No Good, Horrible, Very Bad Day. I didn't start my working career as a family business leader. In fact, for a time I was determined to avoid what might have seemed like the natural or easiest path for me. It was important for me to prove to people around me, my family members as well as people from the business world in general, that I had the talent, the intelligence, the guts, and the work ethic to succeed in any environment, with or without a hand up. Of course, especially in those early years, I also had to prove it all to myself. So I spent several years learning, listening, and trying my hand at other kinds of work in organizations and industries far removed from the world of my family's business. I attended Emory University in Atlanta, where I studied political science and Judaic language and literature, JLL. Not exactly typical subjects for an aspiring business leader, but I spoke and speak pretty good Hebrew, could understand and read texts, so why not JLL? At the time, Emory didn't have many Judaically knowledgeable students, so I was a rare commodity. I became a research assistant to one of my JLL teachers. I also had a Hebrew professor who read newspaper articles to us in between stories about her belly dancing prowess. As for political science, that choice was driven by my interests in politics, going back to when I would watch White House press secretaries give their briefings on TV. My poli-sci classes at Emory were really enriching. My favorite professor, Dr. Merle Black, was an expert in Southern politics. Brilliant, relaxed, charming, tough, and subtly funny. He'd gotten interested in politics while observing his parents working as election volunteers in both presidential and congressional elections in their community in the South. Dr. Black recalled watching his mother and the other volunteers counting the votes, which basically involves sorting paper ballots into two piles based on the responses. However, every few ballots, if there were too many votes for the wrong candidate, those ballots would be changed or discarded without a second thought. Young Merle Black asked his mother, "Isn't that cheating?" He never did get a solid answer to the question. So yes, JLL and poli-sci may not seem like an obvious combination, but they were topics that fascinated me and gave me a solid understanding of human behavior, the dynamics of power, and the importance of religious faith. While studying at Emory, I interned in several positions at CNN. How lucky do you have to be to get an internship at CNN? One of my assignments was to work on the show Inside Politics. My job was simply to do anything and everything that was needed. I even carried Wolf Blitzer's computer bag once. This was in 1992, and as you can imagine, the drama and the excitement was beyond incredible, especially on election night, with Bill Clinton, George H.W. Bush, and Ross Perot vying for the presidency. Control Room A was the place from which all the state-by-state results were communicated in the form of special videotapes known as winner cards. These triggered the on-air announcement of each winner. Many hours into the night, amidst the electric yet controlled chaos, my boss called me over and asked me if I knew who Booker T. Washington was. I said yes, thinking of the famous Black educator from my history classes. Then my boss handed me a tape and said, "Bring this to him in Control Room A right now." I stared at my boss blankly. I wasn't quite sure I was going to do that. Booker T. Washington was dead. Seeing my confusion, my boss yelled, "He's a producer, and this is the Clinton winner card. Get it to Booker in Control Room A now." Ah! I sprinted out of there, got the tape to Booker, who, yes, was a producer at CNN, and told him what it was. Hello, Life Highlight. So, if you were watching Inside Politics on election night in 1992, now you know that I was there. I then took a job at the American-Israel Public Affairs Committee, APEC, in Washington, D.C. Best known for its focus on ensuring strong U.S. support for the nation of Israel, APEC is sometimes described as one of the most effective lobbying organizations in the U.S., which is saying a lot in a country where every industry, social cause, and interest group needs a lobbying effort to advocate for it on Capitol Hill. I spent most of my time in APEC working on legislation and member voting, which gave me some useful insights into public opinion, how it's shaped, and why it's so important. These are things I think every business leader needs to understand. As you can see, these years offered me some valuable learning experiences, but those lessons didn't come without pain. One of my jobs as a legislative assistant was to compile the voting records for members of Congress on legislation of importance to APEC's mission. The most critical dissemination point of these records was during APEC's annual meeting in D.C., when tens of thousands of people gathered to lobby their congressional representatives. Depending on the voting record of each member, APEC could thank them for their support or ask them for their support in the future. So having accurate information about how the representatives had voted on key pieces of legislation was very important. The job of compiling this data was handled using Excel, the computer spreadsheet program that has now become ubiquitous, but which was less widely familiar back in 1996. Unfortunately, I wasn't very familiar with it, and I fucked up pretty badly, mixing up several columns so that members of Congress who had actually voted yes were listed as having voted no, and vice versa. I deserve to be fired. And I was. Most people have gotten fired at some point in their career. It happened to me. But what for most people is just a temporary setback was for me the worst thing that had ever happened in my life. At least the worst thing up to that time. Thinking about it now from a new vantage point in the world of COVID-19, I'm developing a fresh perspective on that. My reaction to being fired goes back to my personality. I am super uber type A, career driven, and I have been since I was 6 years old. Always wanting to achieve and constantly planning how to get there through grade school, high school, college, internships, jobs, graduate school, networking, and sleepless nights worrying about every imaginable detail that I might have gotten wrong and focusing on the new details that I had to tackle the next day. My drive defines me, for good or bad. So imagine someone with this level of obsession making a mistake and getting fired for it. What would this mean to their sense of self-worth? It would absolutely destroy them, just like it did me. I was humiliated, embarrassed, ashamed. It felt like the destruction of everything I valued, including my sense of self. At the time, I had just started dating Daryl, the man who is now my husband, and I was already very much in love with him. I was terrified of what his reaction would be to my firing. I was sure he would dump me. I even wondered whether I could get away with not telling him. But eventually I made the call. I planned to be nonchalant and unbothered. Good luck with that. As soon as he picked up, I started to cry, to the point where I couldn't speak. This, of course, worried and upset him. Once I was able to tell him what had happened, his response shocked me. He chuckled and said, "That's it? I thought something was really wrong. It's just a job. You'll get another one." I told you that I loved him before this call. Well, this comment upped his value even further. It allowed me to put the moment into perspective and cemented for me the fact that he was, and is, the one and only man for me. I made my peace with getting fired. In the days and weeks that followed, as I reflected on my time at APEC, I realized that being so deeply immersed in the political scene and culture of Washington wasn't for me. I think this is an attitude that lots of Americans have come to share in the tumultuous years since then. Maybe leaving APEC at that time was the right thing for me. Maybe it was meant to be, painful as it was. But one thing that didn't change in the wake of my departure from APEC was my attitude toward work. I will always be the extreme type A woman that I was in my 20s and that I have been since elementary school, though I've gotten better at handling disasters, and especially at fending them off before they happen. That's an approach to management that has served me well, including today, when I no longer have to stay up at night wondering whether I might get fired tomorrow. Instead, I have the even longer list of worries that come with being the CEO of a generations-old family enterprise. I also spent some time at RCN, a fledgling cable TV company based in Princeton, New Jersey. It was a startup business that had been launched with venture capital funding by an entrepreneur named David McCourt. My job was to manage the marketing effort for RCN in the Philadelphia area, which was already dominated by the rival company Comcast. I found that the experience of having been fired from APAC had taught me a valuable lesson, namely the importance of being intensely detail-oriented. I was guided by that new awareness as I orchestrated the work of my marketing team, leading weekly meetings to make sure that nothing fell through the cracks. From a business perspective, RCN turned out to be a doomed effort. It ultimately went bankrupt in 2004 after suffering total losses of $4 billion. But working there was an important experience for me. RCN was the first truly capitalist enterprise I'd ever worked for. It's where I learned how to operate in a corporate environment, the demands of entrepreneurship, and what it means to compete for market share. I loved it all. It's also where I developed a sense of what professionalism means to me. A combination of self-reflection and willingness to self-correct with the type A work ethic I'd always brought to any task. Working at RCN meant getting used to operating on overdrive at all times, constantly mastering new skills, and learning from every experience, good or bad. It was grueling and demanding, and I loved it. Most important, RCN is the place where I realized that being my authentic self meant working to be seen as a leader. That's what the rest of my story has been about. Of course, that's a lesson I fully learned only in retrospect, looking back on those early experiences. That's how life works. Events that seem random at the time turn out to help shape who we are and the big decisions we make later in life. Studying politics and working in media didn't lead directly to my career in the dental industry, but they taught me ways to think about communication and managing in the public spotlight that have served me well as a CEO. As you look back on your own first career steps, you too may find that seemingly unconnected happenings have become stepping stones to success. I'm sure the experiences you'll hear about in this book will be different from your own. That's okay. The learnings you can take from them can still be relevant and valuable for you. The time will come when you'll face decisions not unlike the ones I faced as a family business leader. When that happens, knowing what I did may be helpful. Not in a rigid, you must do X kind of way, but as an extra glimpse into the way the life of the leader unfolds. And also, as a source of encouragement, after all, you'll learn that I screwed up plenty of times, and I'm still going. Why can't you do the same? Chapter 2, 100 Years and Counting. Today, a couple of decades after being fired from APAC, I am CEO of Premier Dental Products. It's not a company whose name everybody knows, and it's not an industry that millions of kids dream about joining someday. Dentistry is a big business, of course, but it's not Hollywood, it's not Google, it's not fashion or high tech or pro sports, which means it's not sexy, right? Wrong! It is dentistry, and to me and many others, it's just as cool as self-driving cars. Think about it. All of us in the world of dentistry are providing people the tools for better oral health. We are making them look better, feel better, have less pain, and be more self-confident. What's not awesome about that? Of course, I'm not a dentist. I don't even play one on TV. So what makes me so interested in dentistry? The big reason is history. Our company has been a successful business serving dentists and their patients for over a century, started, run, and led for that entire time by one family, my family. That alone is reason enough for me to love the business. To know that a single entrepreneur, my great-grandfather Julius, started a business in 1913 that would sustain four generations, support hundreds of families, and help provide greater health and happiness for millions more. To me, that's fantastic. So I love Premier for the legacy it represents. I love it for the connections it has created. And I love it because my grandfather loved it. Aside from his wife, my grandfather's greatest love was Premier. He loved the people, the industry, and the opportunities that Premier made available. He understood the dynamics of business and how to build a great one. I share his passion for Premier and his obsessive desire to continue to make it great. On many occasions, people who knew my grandfather have told me, "We can see that you love the business the way Morton did because you deal with it the way he did." I consider that the ultimate compliment. Selfishly, I also love Premier because it gives me the opportunity to build something great, to shape something meaningful and impactful. It provides me with a space in which I can learn and grow, make mistakes, reach my goals, and earn the respect of others. It allows for me to learn from all of our tremendous people. It gives me a way to serve as an example to my children, to show them the meaning of love, respect, hard work, and opportunity, to teach my daughter independence, and to teach my son the importance of a strong partner. I love Premier because in so many ways, it gives me my identity. More than 100 years is a long time for a business to be in existence. Premier is older than many of the most well-known and successful companies in America, from Disney to Marriott, State Farm to Motorola, Caterpillar to Boeing. For a business to be successful, wholly family-owned, and growing over that length of time is truly remarkable. The obvious question, one I've been asked countless times, is, how did it happen? My answer is, where do I start? There is a long list of essential things needed for a family enterprise to remain successful for over a century.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.